This video is brought to you by VinFast.
The one silver lining coming out of the Second World War was the promise that nuclear power could bring boundless clean energy for a modernizing world. But while nuclear did explode in popularity starting in 1954 with the world's first nuclear power plant in Obinsk outside Moscow, in recent years, countries are starting to all but turn their back on this once energy savior. So what's going on? You might be thinking about the Fukushima nuclear plant disaster triggered by the Tohoku earthquake and tsunami that occurred in March of 2011, especially if you look at this graph showing nuclear power production over time. But things get more interesting when you break out this by country. As you'd expect, Japan completely shuttered its nuclear production, dropping from 280 terawatt hours in 2010 before the disaster to just 17 by 2012. While they have been ramping back up slowly, even as of 2021, their 61 terawatt hours of nuclear output pales in comparison to their pre-Fukushima levels. But there's more to this story. If we look at the top nuclear power producers around the world, you'll start to see a trend. While the rate of nuclear adoption skyrocketed from 1965 to 1995, those curves have flattened in the past 25 years. Now, at this point, it's worth mentioning that by sheer numbers, 2021 was the most prolific year of nuclear energy production in history. This was a surprise to me. Nuclear power isn't disappearing, not at all. But the desire and interest to build new plants has been cooling, to say the least. Well, that is everywhere except China. In the same period from 1995 to 2021, China's nuclear output has shot up from 12.8 to 407 terawatt hours, making it number two behind only the United States. The previous number two, France, which has been quite stagnant, reached its peak in 2005 at 451 terawatt hours and has been in decline ever since. But still over 70% of its total energy production comes from nuclear power, the largest of any country by far. So it kind of seems then that the countries that have been doing nuclear the longest are losing interest while the developing world is adopting it more and more. So what's going on here? Does the old guard know something that the up-and-comers don't? Well, the key here is old. Here's a graph showing the nuclear plants in France as a function of how old they are. Being a very early adopter to nuclear power, the average age of a nuclear plant in France is over 34 years old. And that's almost as young as me. These plants were built when the levels of bureaucratic red tape were far lower than they are today. Also, labor rates and material costs were cheaper then, too. This gets to problem number one. It's really expensive and time-consuming to build a nuclear power plant today. This is a major problem because, like everything in engineering, technology gets better over time. For nuclear power plants, their development is often expressed in terms of generations. Generation 1 plants were the early prototype plants that first appeared in the 1950s and 60s, like the Shippingport plant in Pennsylvania and Calder Hall in the UK. The last Generation 1 plant, the Wylfa Nuclear Power Station in Wales, was fully decommissioned in 2015 after 44 years of operation. Generation 2 plants, consisting of pressurized water reactors and boiling water reactors, to name a few, were a market improvement economically and in terms of reliability from Gen 1 plants. Gen 2 systems have 40-year operating lifespans and came online in the 60s. They comprise a bulk of the world's 400-plus commercial nuclear reactors, which should give you an idea of just how aging our nuclear power infrastructure is. The latest and greatest today are Generation 3 plants, which increase efficiency further, raise operational lifespans to 60-plus years, and critically, incorporate more passive rather than active safety systems. One of the big concerns with nuclear power plants, and all things engineering really, is what happens when things go wrong. If your iPhone starts acting up, you reboot it, no big deal. But if your car breaks down, it's a little more serious, but hopefully you can still pull over safely to the side of the road. As a result, these products are refreshed often, but switch to aircraft, and the situation gets more dire and consequential, and therefore aircraft R&D costs are crazy high, and models operate for decades to recoup that cost. It's the same story for nuclear power plants, where major meltdowns conjure images of the end of times. I should probably take a detour here and talk about challenge number two, the perceived safety of nuclear power. And this is a big one. But before I do, I want to take a moment and tell you about our sponsor this week, VinFast. VinFast is a new EV startup, which is a part of a bigger company called the Vin Group from Vietnam. This is part of the amazing part about electric vehicles. When you ditch the ICE engine, you use all that IP,
suddenly a whole slew of new companies can start making EVs. For example, this, the VF9. Or this, the VF8. And in a couple of years, they'll even have an even smaller version called the VF7. So the reason why this car has me excited is because I've been looking for a replacement for my Honda Pilot for a very long time. I have one EV and one gas car. But for me to buy a new EV, it has to have two things. It has to be able to seat 7 or 8 people and have enough room for my Home Depot trips. And I think the VF9 might just do that. With design by Pininfarina, a starting price around $50,000 and range well over 300 miles, this is going to be an amazing addition to the North American EV offering. So if you're interested in reserving one of these vehicles, check the link in the description. We'll have quite a few perks. You can save a little bit of money and be one of the first to check out this car. Huge thanks to VinFast and you for supporting the companies that support this show.
There are thousands of people who opt to drive instead of fly because they believe it to be safer. But the data couldn't be further from the truth. Your odds of dying in a car crash are 1 in 98 in a lifetime. Accounting for the same number of miles, your odds of dying in a plane crash in your lifetime are just 1 in 7,178, according to USA Today. The logical fallacy at play here is the exact same one, and it just might be the biggest challenge for nuclear power. It's the availability heuristic, which says that some memories are easier to conjure up than others. The lasting impression of seeing a horrific plane crash is so utterly infrequent that it's often never forgotten. In contrast, you'll probably see a car crash sometime this week, and as a result, it barely even registers. It's a consequence of our lizard brain's evolution, where it can be advantageous to create shortcuts to arrive at decisions quickly. To talk about nuclear power, then, is to talk about the great disasters in nuclear history. Try this experiment. If you close your eyes and hear a few random words, then nuclear power, odds are you're probably picturing the horrific events of Chernobyl, Three Mile Island, or Fukushima. The two are so inextricably linked in our minds, it can be hard to separate. But what does the data say? Per unit of energy created, you'll see that coal, oil, and natural gas are by far the most dangerous forms of energy. So when you think of death and destruction, maybe you should start picturing fossil fuel power plants because nuclear barely even registers. And this is including the big disasters we all remember. But deaths caused by spewing fossil fuel power plants take time and just don't have as lasting an imprint. Okay, so people have an irrational and untrue fear of the actual dangers of nuclear power. But let's get back to the technology itself. Most of our nuclear power plants today are aging Gen 2 plants, well past their prime. But the good news is the world isn't ready to give up on nuclear power just yet. There are 5 Generation 3 reactors either in operation or under construction around the world. 2 in Taishan, China, 1 in Olkiluoto, Finland, 1 in Flamanville, France, and Hinkley Point C in Somerset, England. These plants are generally referred to as ERPs, or European Pressurized Reactors, or internationally as Evolutionary Power Reactors. You gotta give to the Europeans, they got naming rights on this one. For more countries to start building next-generation nuclear reactors, it's vitally crucial that these 5 succeed. So, how's it going? Well, this is where things go a bit wrong. Starting with the Flamanville, France plant, since the first concrete pour in December of 2007, it's been one problem after another. In April 2008, the French Nuclear Safety Authority reported that a quarter of the welds inspected weren't within spec, and that cracks were found in the concrete base. In August 2010, the same authority reported further welding problems on the secondary containment steel liner. In June 2015, multiple faults in cooling system safety valves were also discovered. From an original estimate of 3.3 billion euros, by the time the plant begins operation, optimistically in 2023, it will have cost 12.7 billion euros. What has happened to our ability to build things? I was recently in New York City and we visited the Empire State Building, where back when it was built, workers were walking around hundreds of feet in the air with no safety equipment, throwing hot rivets around like some sort of crazy video game. Don't get me wrong, I'm all for safety regulations and improved working conditions, but I do wonder. You can't even get on a single-story building today without liability insurance and a safety harness. It just makes me wonder if a lot of the great things we've built in the past would even be possible today. I'd love to hear your thoughts on this, so sound off in the comments below. To end this on a high note, let's talk about what's happening in Finland, where their Gen 3 nuclear plant at Olkiluoto is both on cost and on budget. No, I'm kidding. It's neither. While construction originally started in August 2005 and was planned to be completed in 2012 at a cost of 3.7 billion euros, it ended up costing over 8 billion euros and plans to be online in July of 2022, over 10 years late. Now, while that isn't exactly good news, the Finnish plan to handle one of the key drawbacks of nuclear power really is, and that is what to do with the nuclear waste. Finland isn't just building the largest nuclear reactor in Europe. They're thinking about the entire life cycle of nuclear energy. While spent nuclear fuel can be reprocessed, re-enriched, and returned to energy production, big surprise, today, it isn't. Any guesses why? Of course, it comes down to cost. Doing so is much more expensive than just discarding the spent fuel and buying more. This lack of incentivization to recycle is a huge source of most of our problems. Instead, we ship out spent nuclear fuel that's highly radioactive and dangerous for thousands of years to be stored in special containment systems. But this poses all sorts of issues because it requires regular inspections, security measures to prevent any would-be ne'er-do-wells from doing all sorts of harm, or natural disasters like what happened in Fukushima. It's estimated that about 250,000 tons of nuclear waste is already in some sort of containment around the world, and this number is only going to increase. Posiva, a joint venture between two Finnish nuclear power plant providers, Fortum and TVO, is building the world's first and best permanent nuclear waste facility deep underground. The Onkalo spent nuclear fuel repository, 5 kilometers from the Olkiluoto nuclear power plant. This spiraling underground tunnel network reaches down 520 meters and allows spent nuclear fuel to rest permanently without any active safety systems or human intervention. Here, radioactive waste is housed in boron steel canisters, encased in corrosion-resistant copper capsules, and buried permanently, without the need for any further intervention. What I love most about this approach is that the entire project is funded with tariffs on the nuclear energy produced, which is finally a step in the right direction for true life cycle cost. If you want to see a deep dive on this crazy mega project, leave me a comment. But put simply, Finland hopes to become the archetype of how to handle waste and inspire other countries going forward. Plus, we have a video plan on another crazy cool concept for nuclear waste, so consider subscribing. So let's recap. Is nuclear energy safe? Absolutely. It is one of the safest forms of energy production in history. Do we have answers for how to handle the waste? I'd say yeah. Yes, the Gen 3 European plants are proven to be wildly expensive, but the more we build, the better it'll get. Unlike Europe, China is building nuclear power plants at a much lower cost, largely due to lower labor rates and less stringent red tape. Asia, then, is kind of like Europe and North America was 40 years ago. And with countries like China and India increasing their appetite for electricity, it will be vitally important. Here is a graph of the countries with the largest electricity consumption per capita. Surprisingly, the US is only 11th on this list. This is largely due to heating homes in the winter in countries where natural gas is just too expensive. As a result, most homes have heat pump heating, which uses electricity. But here's the thing. Much of the world is developing, with rising wages, quality of life, and the rise of electric vehicles. As a result, I expect electricity consumption around the world to increase at a staggering rate over the next 10 years. If we instead look at the world's most populous countries, you'll see many, especially India, use a very small amount of energy per capita today. In the US, 12,000 kilowatt hours are consumed per person per year. If India consumed just half as much as the US, and China increased its consumption from around 4,000 kilowatt hours per person per year to 8,000, or two-thirds that of an American, that would contribute to an increase in the world consumption from 23,000 terawatt hours to 36,000 terawatt hours, a 56% increase. And that's just two countries. This is the greatest argument for deep investment in nuclear energy. Even today, low-carbon energy sources like nuclear, hydro, wind, and solar only contribute 15.7% of the total mix. Gas, coal, and oil is 84%. To be against nuclear power, at least today, just doesn't make any sense. I want to see tons of new wind, hydro, and solar power come online, But let's remember what we're up against. We shouldn't think about this as either or. We should be investing in all the wind and solar we can muster, but also be building every nuclear power plant we can. In the operational 60-year life of a Gen 3 nuclear power plant, we will have all sorts of new breakthroughs, and maybe then we can have a discussion about moving on from nuclear fission reactors. But today, with how dirty our current grids are, for reliable, stable, clean energy, nuclear power still reigns supreme. Maybe nuclear fusion reactors will be ready by then. Maybe molten salt thorium reactors will become mainstream. Or how about small modular reactors? Now, these are really interesting because if construction complexity and cost is the big problem with new nuclear plants, small modular reactors just might be the key. By the way, we have videos on all of these topics, which I think you should definitely check out right now. I'm Ricky, this is Tuba Da Vinci, and if you think I've earned it, consider subscribing. Also, join our Discord community and consider becoming a patron on Patreon.